Okay, I've got Smriti Irani also joining us now. The BJP on election days makes sure that all their gunpowder and all their firepower comes out. Smriti Irani, congratulations. I always want to say congratulations because otherwise the BJP feels we are being not entirely fair to them, not entirely generous. Congratulations for Haryana, remarkable win. But in your home state, that it hasn't quite gone according to script. Am I right? Or are you saying it's a massive victory in Maharashtra, ma'am?
You've always had a very unique way of expressing your congratulations. The fact that you give me credit and my party for a stupendous performance in Haryana and deny me that same celebration and jubilation in Maharashtra is something I've missed on news channels for a very, very long time. But let me say that today is a day of absolute jubilation and celebration for all BJP Karyakartas, especially our leadership, which has done stupendously well. The also salutations to the voters who have, through their vote, reflected their strong belief that we are the party that will deliver on promise of good governance.
But the reality, Smriti, also is that the BJP alliance is at 108 seats. You haven't been able to touch the majority mark of 144. Is that
we are talking reality,
an acceptance of the fact that the calculation that you had in going alone hasn't worked
out? Let me reflect on the fact that the entire results for the assembly elections in Maharashtra are yet not out. Since we are reflecting on reality, let me also attract your attention to the fact that there were 171 seats in Maharashtra that the BJP had never fought since our inception as a political organization. And we are also extremely seized of the fact that in mere 12 days, in these seats, we mounted an election which in itself was a political miracle. So irrespective of how you deign our victory, I'm of the opinion that my party and special my colleagues and the Karyakartas have done exceedingly well given our challenges and given the short span of time in which we have performed.
Your gamble of splitting with the Shiv Sena has worked. You're saying the gamble has worked. You believe there is a Modi way. You see it as a Modi way.
I will not have you subscribe words to me as you so kindly try. I will only say this, that we were absolutely sure that Maharashtra is crying out for a Congress Mukta Rajya, and that is what we see today. We see complete decimation of the Congress, not only in Maharashtra but also Haryana.
Smriti, who is the likely partner for the BJP going to be? There are talks on with the NCP, there are talks on with the Shiv Sena. How do you see the BJP be able to form the government?
I am of the opinion that we fought this entire election with the belief that we will be the single largest party, and that belief has been fructified. I am also in the know that I'm not a part of the BJP parliamentary board, hence what the future holds vis-a-vis my parliamentary party in the centre and in the state is something for the members of the parliamentary board to decide and announce. I will only say this, that we fought this election on a decisive fact that people are wanting a change, and that change is reflected in their support for the Bharatiya Janata Party.
Will you go Ekla Chalo Re as a result in all elections? Is it now every election, Narendra Modi at the top, local networks, forget about allies, what you need is Narendra Modi at the top, local networks at the bottom? Is that the strategy?
I will not be presumptuous enough to discuss political strategy at length for a party and a political organization which has many aspects and leadership facets who do come upon decisions which affect both the party at state level and center. I will only say this, that this election, as has been the mandate in Lok Sabha 2014, is extremely decisively in favor of a decisive leader like Narendra Modi, decisively in favor of good governance, decisively against the Congress party.
You know, I've been on TV as a spokesperson as a result. You know, having become a minister, you've given up coming on television channels, so it's nice to hear you. And tell me, is this saffron some kind of a order diktat from the top that all BJP leaders who appear on television channels
again,
have to dress up in saffron?
Condescendingly presumptuous to presume that in a free nation I'm not free to pick my own sari color. But
no, because I've seen every BJP leader who's come on the program dressed in orange, so I was wondering whether this was a diktat.
The only other colleague I've seen in saffron is Nirmala, so I'm presuming that she also takes her freedom in the same spirit that I do and chooses a sari color, irrespective of any kind of decision-making pattern that the Headlines Today party platform
Smriti,
I will only say this, that yes, as minister, I do at times miss the spats I have in television studios.
That's interesting. I'm glad we miss you too, Smriti. Smriti, but tell us, Given what's happened with the Shiv Sena over the past couple of weeks and what's been a bruising campaign, do you think it possible for BJP state level leaders to work with the Shiv Sena again? Or do you think there's now too much bad blood in the alliance for you to be friends with the Shiv Sena again?
Like I said, congratulations and compliments to you for trying to snare me into that verbal duel again and again and make me give some kind of a statement about possibilities in the future. I will only say this, that let the entire results come through. The trends indicate that we are the single largest party, and the trends also indicate a decimation of the Congress party, and I congratulate my leadership and the state and the center both, and our karyakartas and those who have supported us irrespective of up and down in political life. It is to them that this win, this victory is dedicated.
Ma'am, please do come on television channels even to discuss Ministry of HRD. It would be nice if...
I'm more than happy to discuss the ministry on facts, but not on concocted headlines. Thank you.
Okay, on concocted headlines. I know where you're hinting at, but at the end of the day, Smriti Irani, pleasure to have you. Nice to see you. And maybe saffron is the color of preference of all BJP leaders. But Shekhar, before you leave us, final word this morning. The big takeaway from you, one big takeaway, if there's one big takeaway from what we've seen transpire in the last few hours, what is that?
The biggest takeaway is that voters' ideological loyalties are now shifting, in the sense that ideology matters less than it used to before. So voters are willing to shift. At the same time, I think the lesson that Congress learned, BJP also has to learn, which is that for the states, you will need leaders. Now, let Haryana not push them into a delusion that it doesn't matter whether you have a leader or not. Haryana is a different story, and I'll come to that. But Maharashtra tells you that sending Modi there, it's a state adjoining Gujarat, should be most affected by Gujarat and should be most influenced by Modi's personality. By sending him there and saying, trust him with giving you a leader, has not done very much for the BJP. Haryana, on the other hand, tells you something else. Haryana tells you what Punjab told you the other day and what Delhi told you before that, that when people find both the main contestants, both the main claimants untrustworthy. In Delhi, they had checked out Congress and the BJP. In Punjab, they had checked out Akali Dal and the Congress. Then they tried to find a third alternative.
So BJP, interestingly, is the third alternative in Haryana.
Aam Aadmi
because
Party,
people are sick of Hooda as well as Chota.
Aam Aadmi Party got the power in Delhi. And in Punjab, they did very well. BJP went to Haryana as a third different alternative. No dynasty, no ideology, no caste. And people in that state have chosen them.
I'm going to leave it there, Shekhar. I've got to take a break.
There are many other takeaways in this.
I'll get you. You're coming back in the evening. You can give me all the takeaways.
Let me just complete this.
Go ahead.
Since the morning, we haven't mentioned one three-letter acronym, BSP. Right? BSP always mattered in Haryana. BSP always made some difference in Maharashtra. Is something happening to Dalit vote that we are not noticing? Because in Haryana,
in Haryana, it
has shifted to Congress.
Sure, in Haryana, that's true. And in fact, as was suggested, the BJP consciously targeted the non-Jat Dalit vote, and they have done very well. They did well in Western UP with that. They've done well now this time.
Having said that, this is not quite confirmed yet, but it does seem that in the Kerana seat in Western UP, Samajwadi Party has again defeated the BJP.
And I can tell you one thing, my Malishwala, who comes on Sundays from Haryana, he had said 50 seats, sir, aayega BJP ko, they are with 50. So maybe sometimes we need to listen to Malishwalas and even forget about pollsters. He said exactly 50 seats is bar BJP ko aayega. Let's take a break on that point. Next time we'll get Malishwalas, will cost also less instead of Sephora.
And you get a free Malish to go.
We'll get a free Malish also as a result. Give us the result, right? Get a free Malish. Super Sunday, what's turned out to be yet another dramatic day in Indian politics. The results of the states of Maharashtra and Haryana. Plenty for the BJP to cheer about, but plenty also to think about in terms of post-poll alliances. Let's bring you the headlines at the top of the hour. Okay, we'll bring you the headlines in a moment from now, but the big headline, of course, is that the BJP is set to form the next government in Haryana and is in a position to form the next government in Maharashtra, but will require an alliance because Maharashtra has importantly thrown up a hung assembly in this election. Quite a turnaround in that sense in the state of Maharashtra. I want to go to Amiben Yagnik of the Congress, who is joining me at this moment. Amiben, it appears that the Congress has very little to cheer about. Haryana is particularly depressing. You're down to 11 seats. One name that I've not mentioned was Robert Vadra. I'm using Robert Vadra now as a symbol of what many believe was the problem with land allotments in Haryana. That land was given to people close to Mr. Hooda. That was a charge that the opposition made in Haryana. Do you concede that perception-wise, both in Haryana and Maharashtra, the tag of corruption has touched your party, has damaged your party?
Rajdeep, perception does matter. But singling out some land deals and not looking at the unprecedented development that has taken place in Haryana, you just cannot pin or put a blame on one singular point. And these are just charges. And you know that two courts, competent courts, have given a clean verdict on this issue, that the land, of course, the government was not in the loop at all. It was between two private purchasers. But anyway, the results are definitely disappointing to the Congress.
Sorry to interrupt. What I was trying to say is the perception was that land was being allotted in a manner to people close to Mr. Hooda. Ironically, I've also heard people saying that Mr. Hooda has done a lot of development in Haryana, yes, particularly in the Rohtak area. But I've also heard people say ki kuch logo ko unhone ameer bana diya. So somewhere the Congress model of development has come under scrutiny. The same thing is said in Maharashtra, that some people have benefited while others have lost out.
Well, all these charges, you know, Rajdeep, they do not go right up to the finality or to the logical end of getting some kind of a very clear verdict on these. Now, because 5 years is a short time for any matter to get over, you know, in the legal or the regulatory system. So, of course, these allegations remained, and it now remains to be seen whether they definitely were charges that culminated into some real, the allegations have come out as true, but the person perception has done a damage, definitely.
Okay.
And if these are the issues, then let us see what the courts are going to do after looking into it, because no matters can be without any courts or without being tried. So just allegations, then if these allegations are untrue and false, well, yes, there will be a comeback for the Congress.
But I'm glad that you're at least conceding that there is a perception problem that the Congress faces, because I think that in itself is a step towards redemption. Ashok Lahiri,
Because Rajdeep, I'll tell you.
Yes.
I'll tell you why. Because yes, this perception has acted as some kind of a marketing strategy. None of the matters, if you see, where there are corruption charges in the whole of the country, have attained any finality looking, you know, the okay, legal system and the regulatory system. But the BJP has been has been persistently putting this perception across, not telling what is the actual result of these matters. And so the matter has been lingering in the arena. Rajdeep, you listen to me. You listen to me, because the BJP's ministers, though convicted, they are still sitting as ministers. Now, is this not a part of the perception? Why it is not being brought? Whenever you talk about this, that takes a back seat.
Okay. The fact at the moment, though, ma'am, is that the Congress has been in power for longer, and therefore these allegations tend to stick, because you've been in power both in Haryana for 10 years and Maharashtra for 15. But Ashok Lahiri, when you look at this verdict, as you know, again from a cephalologist's point of view, is this anger? Is this a verdict of anger against an incumbent? Or is it about a political party intelligent enough to try and add to its voter base? The BJP looking at the ground to see how it can increase its voter base. What reflects the fact that the BJP has capitalized on the anger in Haryana, and it has been successful to a large extent in capitalizing on the anger in Maharashtra?
I think both.
Is this an anti-incumbency vote, is what I'm asking you?
It's anti-incumbency. You cannot really distinguish between the two, because if you see Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, there was no anti-incumbency.
Madhya Pradesh there was, Rajasthan there was, against Gehlot's government, when Vasundhara won.
Madhya Pradesh was not. Yeah. Not Rajasthan, I'm sorry. Okay. But in Maharashtra, I think it's again, I may sound like I'm being too soft on BJP, but BJP did a wonderful job. What BJP did what would have been the outcome if BJP and Shiv Sena had fought the election together? They would have formed the government. Even now, BJP has the option of forming that government, but it has an alternative. It has an alternative of forming the government with NCP.
And it also has the chief minister's post. It's guaranteed the chief minister's post.
It can keep Shiv Sena in place, and it also has established that in the partnership, just as also NCP has done, NCP has proved that it's the senior partner in the Congress NCP coalition, and BJP has proved that in the BJP Shiv Sena coalition, BJP is the senior most.
There's some breaking news that I'm getting, which is interesting, because at the moment, Siddharth, we are getting reports that RSS's MG Vaidya has made it clear, no question of alliance with NCP, we will back a BJP Shiv Sena alliance. And I know for a fact that Mohan Bhagwat was among those who was upset at the manner in which the alliance broke down in Maharashtra. They felt, the RSS felt the BJP should have gone with the Shiv Sena. Do you get the sense that that will clinch the matters, will clinch matters now?
I mean, that's the final push that this discussion needs.
So even if an Amit Shah or a Narendra Modi wanted to go with
corporates
someone else,
for that matter,
or the corporates want the BJP to go with the NCP, the RSS will have the final word here.
Well, the RSS will be firstly very suspicious of the NCP. Don't forget that the NCP is seen as a corrupt party. The RSS knows that anti-corruption is a platform. And the Shiv Sena, though the Shiv Sena and RSS are not particularly close, but that whole, they understand that the whole Hindutva argument is something that these two can, you know, carry forward.
Is that Seshadri Chari, as someone who's been close to the RSS and
I'm sorry, I'm second guessing the RSS.
No. Seshadri Chari, you are the best to answer this. Would the RSS, let's be clear, there was a feeling that the RSS cadres were not as involved. The one difference between UP and Maharashtra I noticed, in UP, in the general election, the RSS put their entire might behind it. They said this is a junoon. I didn't sense that in Maharashtra when I travelled there. The RSS seemed to withdraw. They were not very thrilled with the idea that the Hindutva alliance was breaking. How do you respond to that?
See, first of all, I don't think this, it, the right word to use is Hindutva alliance. There is nothing called Hindutva alliance in the first place. Number one.
Why Seshadri Chari? Bal Thackeray and L.K. Advani openly used to call it a Hindutva alliance. Today, 20 years later, you don't want to call it Hindutva alliance.
It is not Hindutva alliance.
What alliance was it then?
It is not Hindutva alliance. As far as I know, 12 years of editorship of organizer and 20 years of RSS pracharakship, I have never come across L.K. Advani using the word Hindutva alliance. I have interviewed
Bal Thackeray who said, I want an undivided Hindu vote bank.
Whatever you say, you limit it to Bal Thackeray. I have no objection. I am not an expert on Balasaheb Thackeray.
You are saying BJP never called it a Hindutva alliance.
As far as L.K. Advani is concerned, I am very sure Hindutva alliance is not a word
undivided
that L.K.
Advani
Hindu
vote bank never used by BJP leaders.
The word Hindu vote bank was first used by Swami Chinmayananda and not by BJP. But this is not the time to discuss all those things. I can discuss with this for 24 hours if you want on all these things. And I'm very happy with Manishankar Iyer that he is happy with you because you went wrong. So again, there is another opportunity for me to say that you went wrong on a number of things. Some solace for both of us here.
Attack the anchor. When in doubt, attack the anchor.
No, it's not that. But what the point is, it's not the question of what the RSS wants. It's the question of what the people want. People have chosen, people wanted BJP government, and they would have been very happy if there was about 150 seats for the BJP. But if you are not getting that, the next best alliance would be BJP Shiv Sena because we had no serious difference of opinion. It was probably
a personality clash.
The personality in the sense, it was very easy for Balasaheb Thackeray and Pramod Mahajan or Gopinath Munde or Dharamchand Choradia. We are forgetting Dharamchand Choradia here. These three people were very important, and much before that, it was Vasantrao Bhagwat who actually put all these things together since 1977.
Let's go straight across to Piyush Goyal. Our correspondent Smita Sharma has been speaking to Mr. Goyal, Union Minister, to find out whether NCP or Shiv Sena, who's the choice of the BJP? Listen in to what Piyush Goyal has told Smita Sharma a short while back.
Right, so as the picture now emerges out of Maharashtra, looks like the BJP might really have to once again rely on some political party for an alliance. Joining me here is Mr. Piyush Goyal, who's just landed in New Delhi, is en route, in fact, to the BJP headquarters, Union Minister for Power, Coal, and Minister of State with Independent Charge, of course. Mr. Goyal, I'm going to focus here on Maharashtra specifically. You come from Mumbai, you know the city. You know, while the mood of the country by and large seems to be going in for decisive mandates, what is it really with Maharashtra and its split verdicts?
It's not hardly a matter of a split verdict. The issue is we had never fought more than 119 seats. And I suspect we may once again land up getting 119 seats. So a state where the party for 30 years has almost been relegated to third or fourth position with a small presence. We have emerged as the single largest party. We'll have about very close to the majority mark.
Right.
And I think it's a big victory. We are extremely delighted.
Congratulations, of course, in fact, emerging as the single largest party there, but you'll still fall short of those 30, 40 odd seats. So is the door going to reopen for the Shiv Sena, really? Because they seem to be emerging as the second largest party there.
Well, Shiv Sena minister continues to be with me in the cabinet. We were on the flight together yesterday.
Right. So that definitely seems an indication. It's not going to be a case where perhaps somebody like the NCP might be a new alliance partner. Will that be more comfortable for the BJP?
I don't see any reason for us to explore new partnerships. It was an unfortunate thing that they did not recognize the strength of the BJP. But I think you already heard Mr. Uddhav Thackeray a couple of days back expressing the fact that allies and friendships don't disappear in a month. And I see no reason for us to explore new options.
And perhaps this is something that Mr. Modi had as sort of visualized, and that's why he didn't really go in for a frontal attack on the Shiv Sena during his campaign.
But there was nothing to attack. It was only a question of a seat adjustment that did not work. There was no other reason for us not to align and fight the election.
No, but if the people of Maharashtra are now voting for the BJP, you know, in effect, you've been saying that these votes are largely because people want good governance, which is promised by Mr. Modi. But if they're still voting for the Sena as well, which has continued to be in BMC, they somehow failed, you know, to deliver in terms of governance and administration there.
Well, even in Mumbai, the largest party would probably be the BJP. From whatever last I heard, as I landed, we are getting more seats than any other party in Mumbai. So the fact is that the people of Maharashtra have voted largely for the BJP. We have emerged as the party of choice. Mr. Modi's leadership has been established. A 46-seat party going up to about 115 is a 150% increase, which has rarely happened. In Haryana, it has gone up from 4 to 48 or 50 maybe. So it clearly establishes the people still believe that the only choice and hope for the country, for its development, progress, is Shri Narendra Modi.
You know, that's a good point. From 45, Surjit, they've come up to 115 is what their latest tally is. That's about 150% jump. Can it therefore be said that people have voted for a saffron alliance? That at the end of the day, it's either BJP or Shiv Sena. So between the two of them, they've got about 175 seats. Would that be a better way of interpreting Maharashtra, rather than suggesting that the BJP has fallen short of a majority and the opposition has prevented a BJP-led government, that it's a vote for a saffron alliance?
Well, let me try and answer in terms of the big takeaways, which
yes,
is more or less what you're asking. The first is that the gamble did not pay off. I thought for one that the gamble would pay off. It was a very educated, it was a very good gamble. As you discussed earlier, there is nothing lost by the BJP. That is, they'll still be forming the government. And if you will, in the terms of seat sharing, I think if I'm not wrong, the BJP was offered about 119 seats or so to contest. And what they have won is about that much. So it is a clear victory for the BJP, but clearly not as much as they or anybody else, if you will, most of the exit polls, except yours, I have to congratulate you, expected them to do relatively not as well as this. So that's the first big takeaway. Second, if you include Haryana in it, there is a wave.
Yeah.
If you take the composite, there is a wave in favor of BJP.
So that's
my second takeaway from this. And the third takeaway is that the Congress has lost very, very badly. So if you, these are the three big results from this election.
Okay, so you've given
us. I don't think they're that much. And lastly, in terms of if you take the Lok Sabha elections, state elections in the Lok Sabha, and now, this is the one election where the splitting of the vote, the suffragist thing, etc., did not work. So it is something we'll all have.
Okay, I need to take a break because speaking of cephalology, this is one election. The BJP has clearly defeated the Congress. And in this election, at least, Cicero has defeated Chanakya. That's very clear. This is a triumph for Cicero and not for Chanakya. So just a reminder, a gentle, humbling experience for all, including pollsters. Do not believe that you get every poll right. The Indian voter has his own strange way of bringing both pollsters and politicians down to earth.